Thank you all for coming today. We're here to share the story of how we have been able to design and start Makerspaces, and we're going to share some different models with you so that what we hope you're going to take away with you is that there is no right way to design a Makerspace, and any opportunity for students to be able to learn hands-on is wonderful for all students. So you'll see us pass around the microphones as we all hop in and add our versions of what we did. First, let me introduce who's here on the panel. This is Jerry Gargus. He's the principal of Maga Elementary in Los Alamitos Unified School District. Sunghie Okino, she is the principal at Los Alamitos Elementary. Alex Ordonez, he is the Makerspace lead teacher slash media center specialist. And May Samari, and she is the Makerspace lead teacher slash media specialist. Alex is at LAE, Los Alamitos Elementary, and May is at Maga. So the outsides go together, the insides go together. I'm kind of off on the side, just watching it all happen. All right, what we're really sharing is what was designed to be for students has turned into the world's biggest engineering design process project on an ongoing basis. So we're continually going through that same process that we actually want the students to learn and take on and apply in everything that they do and transfer into the classroom is actually what we're doing all along the way. So we're continually learning, gathering feedback, watching the students, and improving along the way. So when you look at the engineering design process and you see, first we had to identify the problem. Well, we knew we needed makerspaces in our schools, and then research and brainstorm what was best for students, and that's where you see a difference between school sites, because what we really believed in when we all were talking about and brainstorming the vision for what should we do in our school district, what we all agreed on was that we really wanted to make sure that what we designed matched the students in the specific schools. So what was best for those students, those teachers, that principal, and everyone who was on the leadership team, the committee, and the parents? And that would be the most successful. And then how are we going to build it? You'll see that we had different methods of building it, and right now they're starting to look very different, which is excellent, because then you know that it's really matching a population. It is not a box, it's not a kit, it's not a set. You can't go from one school to the other and see the same thing. It's very much not a cookie cutter design on purpose. And then we've been testing it and improving it and so forth. And so now we're to the point where it says present solutions. And what's interesting is that whenever you apply for Q, it's always in October. So I don't know if anyone knows that. And here we are in March. So we were hoping we would be at the point where we had some solutions to share. Fortunately, we do. So we're here today just to share what's gone really well for us, what we've learned along the way, lots and lots of lessons to share with you in case you're going through the same process or you're considering doing it in your school district. Here's an overview of what we've been doing. It's 3 minutes. Our kids are natural makers, builders, creators, innovators, outside-the-box thinkers. They have access to robots and all kinds of after-school activities now. Our students now have Project Lead the Way in many middle schools and high schools across the United States. What are we doing to prepare our students from being the natural builders that they were as children to being able to do the engineering and design and technological innovation that's required when they hit middle school? How can we bridge that gap between the natural makers, builders, and creators that they are as young children and Project Lead the Way and engineering in high school? You're all here today because you all believe, just like we do, that makerspaces are a great way to bridge the gap, to give the children the opportunity to make, create, discover, explore, and make those connections between the classroom and the things they've been doing outside of the classroom.
Look at that tube that's in there. It's perfect.
But it's super glue. I'm trying to see if I can cut these wires out so I can go.
Interesting.
Oh, have I seen how strong it was? Very good. So other than a hurricane, what other severe type of weather could affect your house? Oh, stormy, exactly. So let's see. How are you going to fix that? Try to fix it up.
hopefully that gives you a big picture of what it looked like. As with any kind of change, innovation, anything that we do, it all starts with a vision. So right now we're all going to share about what the vision was that we all came together on, and then how that vision was then segmented and really scaffolded for everyone, from the parents, the students, the teachers, and even everyone in the district.
Okay, so we all believe that our students should be assessment-capable learners, independent learners in charge of their own learning. So what we started with is, in a year ahead of our makerspace coming into play, we shared our vision with the teachers by sharing articles, talking about the purpose of having a makerspace, what kind of learning do we want to see coming out of it. And lots of one-on-one conversations, small group conversations, and whole staff conversations. And then we also shared the vision with key parents, because we wanted the parents to understand what our makerspace is and why we're doing this. By the time we got to summertime, we had a group of teachers who committed to meeting as a leadership committee in the summer. And we got together to co-build our makerspace, to design it, to come up with how we're going to structure it and establish makerspace norms.
Wow, okay, so Sunghie took a very different approach, very much more comprehensive. I, as a principal, was brought into the makerspace idea by watching Kane's arcade video and all those wonderful things. And we were actually in the process last spring of launching another major initiative on our campus of full inclusion co-teaching with our general ed and special ed population. So the idea of launching a makerspace program simultaneously was a little bit daunting. And I don't know that I was all the way there as a leader. And in early August, Trish came to me and said, Jerry, let's go walk your campus and let's talk about this. And as we're walking, I'm hearing what makerspace is more and more, and I'm thinking, ooh, we're a traditional type of school. We do things for a long time here. We take our time with things. And we just lost our two media center people because they retired in June, and I hired an amazing new talent that's just down here to the left, and I don't know what she thinks about that. And we're walking in classroom that we were looking at, as, and Trish is saying, this will be awesome, it'll be great. And I'm feeling very uncomfortable. And then I realized that we had to do it. The uncomfort of that made it perfect for us, because we can't really kind of slowly turn as a school. We have to kind of do those turn on a dime type of things. And we're kind of like an aircraft carrier with 850 kids. So literally it was like one of those epiphany things where I was like, all right, let's do this. Because this is the way I want my kid to learn. So we've got to make sure these kids learn this way. So that was really our very thorough process of vetting this with our staff. And if I had a rewind button as an instructional leader of a campus, I certainly would have pushed it long ago. We still would be doing it, but I would have brought more people into the fold in the process the way that Sunghie did. That being said, we have the perfect facility for a makerspace and for an innovation lab. We were fortunate. We hired a perfect person to take that project on. We are a little limited because both of our schools have part-time people running our makerspace. So we were getting ready to launch. And about a week before school starts, the classroom that we were getting ready to set up, we added a fourth grade classroom that went in there. Yeah, so then I had no space. And then we looked at it and we basically redesigned our entire media center and innovation and turned it into the innovation lab. We moved our library components around, we moved everything around, and we did it all on the fly. And it's worked out beautifully. We've grown and changed. I think that's, if I could give anybody advice on how to do this, one, do the things that Sunghie talked about as far as bringing your staff along. Our staff is there and they love it, and they love the experience that kids are having. I would have gone a little bit slower in retrospect. That being said, innovation doesn't happen slowly. Innovation happens quickly. And we started the year with a slogan at our first staff meeting of break it, make it, share it, take it. And really, as we've gone along, we've kind of done that. So I'm going to pass the microphone down to...
Actually, turn over to Trisha.
Along with the vision, one of the things that we all discussed and agreed upon was that there should be some non-negotiables. What are the big ideas and the things that we want to make sure that all students have in the makerspace? The first one, I should have brought my glasses, was infusing the academic vocabulary. So we wanted to make sure that everything that was going on in the makerspace was also being reinforced in the classroom and vice versa. And so much of that right now is the academic vocabulary. So we all agreed that anytime we were doing anything with the concepts of engineering, science, and so forth, the actual vocabulary would be used with the students, for the students, and by the students. We also wanted to make sure that it was always across the disciplines. So everyone's talking about STEM or STEAM or some version of that. We really wanted to make sure that it was interdisciplinary and truly integrated. So all activities, when we share a few of the different ideas of how we did the planning and how we really designed it to make sure it was transformational, one of the key components was that it really did incorporate, every activity really does incorporate science, technology, engineering, math, and the arts. Not art, but actually the arts. So there might be, it might be some hip hop, some poetry, some something with literature, any area that really represents the arts. We also wanted to make sure that it was aligned to classroom instruction. The big goal, really, is that the classrooms look like the makerspaces. So in many classrooms, they may already look like that, but in some, they're still more traditional. So the paradigm shift and the change that's necessary for students to really pull off this innovation can be modeled in the makerspace, and the goal is to get it aligned to the classroom instruction so that then the teachers value it more. When what's going on in that space matches what's going on in the classroom, there's such a high value that the teachers have the buy-in. They want to be in there, and then you have this reciprocal relationship, much like you have between the homeschool connection, that's so powerful for all learners. We also wanted to make sure it was hands-on. Inquiry-based discovery and no worksheets. That was a key component. Because we know that if they're going to be learning through hands-on and it's inquiry but through all the questioning, we wanted to make sure that the makerspace teacher, when we get to the role of the teacher, we'll talk about that a little more, but the big piece was we wanted to make sure that we were as hands-off as possible, the students who were hands-on as possible, and we were asking questions and facilitating, not teaching and guiding. So it was really much more of the discovery-based, and we all agreed that was the goal of our makerspace. We also had some obstacles to overcome. I'm sure you have some of these as well. I'm just going to share what they are, and then everyone's going to share what they did to solve the obstacles. So one of them was space. As Jerry spoke already, it was a space issue with classrooms, last-minute classrooms being added and so forth. They'll talk about how they solve those. Materials, where do you get them? What materials do you buy? How in the world do you even decide? Do you use Donors Choose? What is it that we use to try to gather these materials? And are they useful for what we actually want them to do? We'll talk about that. Time for equal access. How do we make sure every student in the classroom in the school actually gets to benefit? Perception and misconceptions, that was the piece that I had the biggest part in. I do believe that's a huge obstacle for any teachers who are very didactic or very used to teaching a certain way, more lecture style, or more they like to be in control of the material or a focus on content. It's a big paradigm shift to conceptual understanding and being able to shift over to the hands-off, ask questions, and let the children discover a much higher level of trust and so forth. So that, and there was also a district-wide perception and misconceptions. So when someone comes in and they don't understand what a makerspace is or they weren't part of the vision-making process, then it's easy to come in and say, oh, the kids are playing. Wow, it's really noisy. Wow, it's really messy. What in the world does this have to do with test scores? How are you going to show me that test scores go up when I'm seeing this going on in the class, in this makerspace? Those types of things are something that would go on in any school district, and it's very important to have someone who's there to who's able to share the research, the background, the knowledge, and the vision-making process with everyone so that all stakeholders understand and value the purpose and the meaning behind all of that, what could look like chaos at some moment, to be honest with you. There really is such a rationale behind it, and the true learning is embedded very deeply.
So we're going to go through each obstacle and kind of give you the story of how we approach the obstacles. Over time, so slowly over time, if you look at the top photo, you'll see that we had a very traditional computer lab. When I first got to the school 10 years ago, we had a broken down computer lab with Apple IIe's. We're a Title I targeted school, and so over time, we slowly, through parent fundraising and other funds, brought in more and more devices. So we finally got to the point where after we talked a lot about student talk, more student talk, less teacher talk, turning the learning over to students, how do we do this? We decided that with enough mobile devices, we could dismantle our computer lab. We didn't need desktops anymore. In fact, those desktops were later repurposed to break apart because they were at the end of their life. So we dismantled our computer lab and we just reorganized the tables, brought in shelves. And you'll see that we added wheels to the bottoms of our already existing computer tables so that we can move it around and configure it any which way. We had no idea what we were going to put on shelves. We thought maybe we'll put projects on shelves, but that soon became something that we realized we could not do because we have TK through 5 students and we have 730 students. So how do you put 730 projects on the shelves in that room? You can see that we had a teacher leadership committee that met in the summer to help us do this. One of the things that we also realized is that we put the materials on the shelves and we did kind of a dry run and we found out that it creates congestion. And so in the next picture, you see that we started to put the materials on the tables and spread it around. Otherwise, everybody would just go to the same spot in the shelves and it created more chaos than we intended. So we had a computer lab that we could dismantle and create our makerspace.
So at MAGA, we have a beautiful media center, just one of the most beautiful libraries you'll see around. And like Jerry said, a week before we started the school year, our makerspace room got taken to be a classroom. So we had to completely change our library. Unfortunately, we have a big enough space to do so. So we had to move about half of our books to one end, and we changed the other half to the innovation lab, which is what we call our makerspace. And what's interesting about the space is that we still have library going on simultaneously with the innovation lab, and then also the innovation lab is a walkway from the computer lab to the library. So it's a very busy space, but it's a very active hub of the school. And another thing that we did is we used rolling tables, so tables that folded up and could roll, so we can kind of change that space to whatever we wanted very easily. We also had a rolling rack, as you can see right there, and just like Sunghie said, like, we found that if you bring the tubs to them on the rolling rack, it makes it much easier than having it on the outer space. So like we had a lot of teachers that came and parents that were volunteered in the media center the year before, and they were very shocked and surprised to see the changes that happened in our media center.
You know, I think as a principal, the role is to get the right people in place and then empower them to do great work. So when it came down to questions about space, and May would come to me, she would say, Jerry, we really need this. I didn't really ask a whole lot of questions. I just said yes. And I didn't know what it was. And I didn't know why. I didn't really ask her, why do you need that? Because there would have been a lot of why do you need that? And hey, can we send this letter to parents asking them for supplies? Yes. We need this. How do we get this? Yes. And I think that there had to be a lot of yeses along the way in order to, one, empower her as a new team member with our staff, and two, empower her to create this new vision for how this absolute heartbeat of our campus, this is the heart of the MAGA campus, this facility that we're talking about. So to move things around in it, it's somewhat sacred ground. We have a 6-foot-tall papier-mâché dragon that is more important to the school than the principal, and I'm well aware of that. There's also a life-size papier-mâché cow that is equally more important to the school than the principal, and I'm well aware of that. And those had to have a home in that space. That sounds small, but it was this balance, I think, of how do we balance our traditions and things that are core and essential to our school with this new way of thinking? So the answer was, say yes a lot as a principal, and as a sorry principals, I'm putting you on the hook for this now, but it had to be say yes, because I didn't really understand everything that she wanted to accomplish, and I had to trust that it was gonna be great, and it is.
Well, and if you're curious, there's a little snippet of the dragon in that picture right there.
So you, right now you might be thinking, well, we don't have a computer lab to redesign, and we cannot redesign our library, so what do we do? Well, we do have a couple of schools that are in that boat, and so what they're doing is they're making mobile makerspaces. And I have heard of some other school districts that have visited with us who we've been working with, and they're doing the same thing. So the mobile makerspaces also work, where the parent volunteers are coming in. There's not a dedicated media center teacher or a makerspace lead teacher who's available to do the planning. There are some parent volunteers at every school that would love to take this on.
So the beauty of this is that none of us really knew what we were doing. And so we launched into it, jumped into it, and told ourselves, you know what, we'll design it as we go. And so after the summer leadership committee got together and started this project, we said, oh, you know what, we would love to have a media center teacher because we didn't have one. And that's when we found Alex. And he became part of our design team. So Alex is going to talk about what we did with our time. How do we find time for everyone? Because our vision was really to have every kid and every teacher enter this space at least once a week for 45 minutes.
Do you guys mind if I stand up? Is that okay? Okay. So as you see here, the Makerspace... our schedule was pretty much our media time schedule from the year before. So we kind of switched it around. As Dr. Okino said, that we have TK through fifth grade. They come in once a week for 45 minutes. That gives every single student the same opportunity to experience the makerspace. So I know when I speak to a lot of people, they're like, oh, our grade level wants to do this. Just the science, you know, science grade levels want to do this. But having every single student experience it, I would totally recommend that to everyone. It's a beautiful thing, and students get so excited about it. And we've had parents come up, oh, my daughter, the first thing she says on Monday is, guess what, we have Makerspace on Thursday. And she's like, well, today's Monday. What are you talking about? And they get excited about it. And Dr. Okino has made a point for every single teacher to experience it as well. It was not an option, making sure that every single teacher is in there. It's not a release time. And it's so important for them to be there, make those classroom connections. They can observe their students and see how they act in a makerspace setting.
So my dream really is, and our dream really is, that every classroom will run just like a makerspace, and that's how our children will learn. So in order to make this kind of transformational change, it was really important for us to make sure that every kid and every teacher experienced it themselves so that they can carry it back into their classrooms.
So revisions and time are an exciting process at McGaw, because we have, first, as a principal, priority is that I want all students participating in Innovation Lab. That means that they can't go to Innovation, our classes can't go to Innovation Lab the same time that we have our most struggling students going to Reading Lab. We also have a number of other activities on campus. We have music 45 minutes once a week. We have art lab 60 minutes every other week. We have the reading lab 45 minutes a day, 4 days a week for our struggling readers. So we're trying to, and then we had students going to Innovation Lab 45 minutes one day a week at the beginning of the year. And what we were finding was it was that all of the things that we were trying to do, all beautiful in isolation, were I felt like they were negatively impacting our core instruction. So going into winter break, we actually restructured our time. So we pulled everything off of the first hour of the day to the greatest extent possible, which limited us because we only have May 3 days a week. And we also restructured the way that May is bringing classes to the Innovation Lab for that time. And I'm going to let her talk about that because she can speak far more eloquently than I can.
So instead of having a class every other week consistently, I just schedule with the teacher all of fifth grade, maybe for 2 or 3 weeks intensely, and then I'll do fourth and third. So it's a as-needed basis or as-scheduled basis.
With that, the expectation is still every child in every grade level has the experience, so teachers don't get a chance to opt out. This is a non-negotiable. Teachers don't get to opt out of bringing their kids to Innovation Lab. That's equity and access that we're not willing to compromise.
SDC and ABA.
And we also include, of course, every single one of our students with special needs, and that includes a moderate to severe autism program that services about 60 kids on our campus. And those kids learn right alongside with our general education students as part of our inclusion program. That's been a principle that's been a part of McGough many principles back. And that's been a tradition at our school, is to make sure that we are including our students with special needs to the greatest extent possible, which really, it's beautiful because we see kids shine that might struggle with a reading class or with math or any of the other parts, but then they come into Innovation Lab and it's beautiful because the students that might not have the best of time during some type of math instruction that's just really they're struggling with, they can go into Innovation Lab and they can put something hands-on to that math, and then they can work through it collaboratively. I think that's the piece, that there's that collaborative learning that takes place in the Innovation Labs. It happens in our classrooms, absolutely, but it just gives kids a different opportunity to shine and to be successful in school.
I'm going to hop in. Jerry mentioned something that was really key to the original vision that we haven't mentioned yet, and that was the fact that it was non-negotiable for the teachers to be there. I think that's very unique, and it's very specific to our design in both schools, that the teachers, it was not a drop-off release time opportunity for students. The teachers actually had to be there as well, because the whole point is that the learning and the model of the engineering design process and STEM thinking and planning integrated learning goes to the classroom. In fact, we talked about it from the very beginning. Sorry, May, sorry, Alex, but we were up front, right? If they're successful, which they absolutely are, could theoretically be possible that in a couple of years we could close down the makerspaces because the classroom will look the same. That is success. The impact is already moving into the classroom, which is what we really ultimately want. And that all started with the communication between Alex and May and the teachers, and holding the teachers accountable for actually being in that space so they see what's being modeled. They see what the children are doing. They see the questioning. They see how the inquiry style goes. And all of that is actually a big piece of that big picture.
Okay, so we're going to move on to materials. So we really started with a wide net and had to funnel down to what we really needed. So at our school, we really didn't know what we needed, but we knew we needed materials. So we put out a letter to parents and we kind of threw in what we thought we needed, and Trisha helped us with that. We asked for empty toilet paper rolls, paper towel rolls, any broken down electronic equipment. Please save that for us over the summer and bring it to us at the beginning of the school year. And interestingly enough, because our community at that time didn't fully understand what a makerspace was, they did save some, but we didn't get enough. So we got some very interesting parent donations in the beginning of the year. And we wanted to start it out with our teachers experiencing the makerspace, and so we didn't have enough materials. So we actually went out and bought some of these materials, like plastic caps and things like that, to have that available. And then we started to notice that some of the materials that were coming in were not necessarily safe and useful. We were actually starting to get a lot of junk. People were cleaning out their garages and thought, oh, you know what, I'll just throw in some old pipe cleaners that have bugs on them. And so we thought, uh-oh, okay, this is not what we really want. We did not want to be a junkyard for everybody who gave us things that they didn't need at home. So then it became, we needed to look at what the tasks were, so we began to ask for more specific materials, and as we aligned closer to the NGSS, that even funneled down the types of materials that we needed.
The role of the classroom teacher, it started off with just observations and student questioning. So They're just observing the students, see how they act in this type of space, see what type of learning is going on, what academic vocabulary they are using, and then see what they could bring back from the makerspace into their classroom. It involved into co-planning with the lead teachers and co-teaching as well. As a lead teacher, you'll see in the next slide, I'll explain what I do more specifically. But it has changed and evolved, which is part of the engineering design process. As a lead teacher, I am in there. I thought I was just going to leave the materials and let it be. And now it's more of the coaching the teachers how to align those connections with NGSS. And again, like I said, originally I thought it was going to be makerspace into the classroom, and now it is classroom into the makerspace into the classroom. So it is so powerful when everything is going on at the same time. Again, connecting with what they're learning in the classroom. You'll see a video shortly of how a teacher just explains that they are using those academic vocabulary terms. They are learning, making those connections. And again, just whenever I'm in there, ask questions. Don't tell them what to do. That is so important. I always tell the students that we, as adults, we don't give the students time to just think. We always want an answer, or we give them the answer. Let them think. Let them explore. Let them discover. I'm sorry. We had fourth and fifth graders discover Newton's second law on their own. And just, it's amazing what these students could do. It's just beautiful. And just, so it's, as a lead teacher, and just every teacher in there is a lead teacher. The administration is a lead teacher. Like, look at what these wonderful principals are saying. Our teachers, it's just wonderful being in there. And everyone is a lead teacher in the makerspace. Even the students are lead teachers in there. They are asking each other questions and collaborating and everything. So
I just wanted to jump in really fast. In the beginning, you're going to get teachers who are, I'm on board, I'm fired up. Then you're going to get the teachers who are like, oh, I don't know. And then you're probably going to get teachers who are like, I don't really want to do this. So that's what we started out with in the beginning. Your role is just to go in there and question, ask questions. And asking them questions like, do you think you should use this pen versus this book, is not really asking them true questions. That's, you're doing the thinking for them. So it was practice for the teachers to ask these questions. And I'm going to pass this over to May.
Well, I just want to add for parent volunteers as well, that takes a training to not let them, parents want to actually do it for them. That's like embedded in them. And just to teach them to not give them the answers, to guide them. And that's actually, I think, a little bit trickier than the teachers as well. But Alex, you covered it pretty well, of the role of the teacher.
Thank you.
So the role of the principal is to truly, of course, keep the vision alive, provide resources, just like Jerry says. I never say no to Alex. I never say no to any of the teachers in my school. You want something? You got it. What do you need? But I always ask the question, how does it connect to the learning, and what is your purpose? Okay, because we really want to align it to the learning. And co-plan. You know, Alex and I work very closely together. We work with the other teachers in collaborative teams. We work with Trisha. We work with our other schools in our districts. So co-planning is really, really important. And of course, you've got to be in the space, and you've got to be talking to the students. What do you like about the makerspace? What are you doing? You know, what have you discovered? So you want to ask the kids what they think, and that will give you a boatload of information that will help guide where you need to go next.
I kind of think that the same way that the Innovation Lab itself has evolved, that the role that I played, I think, has evolved as a principal from initially just like, one, championing it with our staff and helping our staff to build an understanding and working with May on that piece. So that was a lot of the initial work. And also really basically being a salesperson within our community, with our parent community, and selling this idea of, we're changing something we've done for 10 or so years, and we're going to replace it with this, and trust us, your kids will love it. And getting that message out through we have McGaw Connect, which is our parent newsletter that goes home every week. And just really, I think that was a piece there. I think that what's evolving to is I need to create venues for our classroom teachers, and we have a couple of them out here, who I encourage you to talk to after this, by the way, because they have some great things to share. Facilitating communication between our full-time staff and May, because she's there 3 days a week. One of the things as we go through the spring is trying to find ways to create opportunities for them to collaborate about aligning the classroom more tightly with Innovation Lab, or aligning Innovation Lab more tightly with the classroom. And I think that's reciprocity in that whole endeavor. So I think that will be the role that the principal plays moving forward, is really making sure we facilitate communication and help build bridges on staff the way we've built bridges out to the parent community already.
The role of the parent volunteers, again, it varies with the model makerspace you have. We originally, during a PTA meeting with parents, we had them experience a makerspace challenge that we do. And what we do is, again, just like May put it perfectly, parent volunteers want to do. They want to help. They want to, you know, just do it for the students in the class. But it's like, that's not the vision. It's letting the students have that opportunity. One aha and thing I would like our makerspaces to have is to have more of a parent and community connection to the makerspace. I'm doing bits a year two, so I think that's like CSTP 3.4 or something, but connecting the community and parents, bringing them into the makerspace and see what they could do. Bring in engineers around your community, bring in firefighters, bring in, you know, anything, even someone who works, it doesn't matter what their job is, they could add that connection to what you are learning in the classroom. And just whenever adults are in there, they're like, I wish I had this when I was younger. Well, we do have it now, and you guys are gonna do it. And if you can make that community and parent connection, that would be a very strong thing. So I would recommend that as well.
Adding on, I think a lot of parents, they don't really know what goes on in the makerspace or the innovation lab. So whenever parents come, they say, this is what it is? Like, this is awesome. Like, every parent should have to volunteer. And I say, yep, every parent should. Because it is so different than what they experienced when they went to school. So just trying to get as many parents to come in and just see what's going on is helpful.
And this is another one of our wonderful, I'm sorry, my arm. One of our wonderful teachers. She's a first grade teacher, Nicole Walters, and here she is. We have other teachers here as well.
In the beginning of the Makerspace challenges, a lot of the challenges were just kind of in isolation from what was being taught in the classroom. So they were based on something scientific or a concept, but basically we would get the challenge and we would show like a brain pop or some kind of video or read a book about it so that the students had some kind of background about what they were gonna go do. They had to make a car, and they were learning about the whole concept of like forces and motion and push and pull. So they had to design a car with materials such as recycled water bottles and rubber bands and bottle lids. And they had to make a car and see how far the car would go. And that was one of the challenges that the students loved, and it was great, but it wasn't anything that we were learning in class. So we kind of had to give them a little bit of background knowledge in class before they went and did the challenge. And the challenges were great and they loved them, but it wasn't directly connected to the standards that were being taught in the classroom. At that point, he kind of got with the grade levels and kind of mapped out and planned out what they would be learning in class, and then he designed challenges around that. So since then, we've had three challenges based on what the first graders are learning in class and what we're teaching them in class, and they have been so much better, and the kids are now, I think they're making a connection to what they're learning in class, to what they're doing in the makerspace, a transfer that they're actually learning something in class, they're going and actually applying what they've learned in class to a challenge. It's making the way they speak, the language they use, the concepts in class that they're transferring to the Makerspace Challenge so much more real for them. They're understanding it. They're feeling more successful, and it's making a huge difference even on what they're learning in class, and then the challenge as well. In first grade in earth science, with the NGSS standards, we now do space systems. And so they learn about the moon and its phases and how the sun, the moon, and earth all interact with one another to cause day and night and seasons. So our last challenge in the makerspace was a constellation challenge. And the students had to look on the walls and identify constellations in the stars on the walls. And my class was very successful with it. In fact, identified all three constellations. They had to learn about animals and how animals survive in their habitat, things that they do, and body parts they use to survive in the habitat. And so the makerspace challenge that week was to have an insect. They were all given an insect, and they had to camouflage their insect in its natural environment so that they, to keep the insect safe from any predators. Because the students were understanding what it meant to be camouflaged and how they live and survive in a habitat, the background knowledge that they had in the classroom, the challenge was a piece of cake for them.
And you see a huge difference when
huge
it's...
Huge difference. Huge, because not only is it helping with their learning in class, because then they're saying, oh, I mean, they're shouting out that this is what we're learning in class, and they don't even realize that we have joined with Mr. O to make sure that the challenges were connected, but they're identifying that. And it's making, I think, the classroom learning is making it come alive in the makerspace, and they're applying it, and they're actually seeing constant.
The big takeaway that we wanted everyone to realize is that we really did put that engineering design cycle into practice, and we're still going through, we're still improving and learning along the way, and there are so many things that would be different if we did this again next year. But the big idea is that there's so much variation and choice for teachers, for the makerspace teachers who are leading it. It's not being led by the district. It's being led by the people who are actually in the schools working with the students. And now it's being led by the students who are telling the teachers and the makerspace teachers what they want to do. And the reciprocal relationship between that makerspace and the classroom teacher is just beautiful. Here are just a few images of what that looks like in the classroom. And one of the things we were going to just mention very quickly, we really want to stop and give you a chance to ask any questions you might have of the panel, having in case you have any interest in starting it or continuing things or something that we said sparks some question you have. But we wanted to mention that one of the first steps we did was having the teachers become the students. And that seems to be a critical piece that's been very successful. So when the teachers go into the makerspace for the first time and they actually get to interact with the materials and take on some of those challenges, they get to be the student and discover what it feels like to have someone just question you, what it feels like to have someone embed the academic vocabulary without actually telling you this is called a blah, 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 just by the way that they question. And that has seemed to be very powerful throughout the year. A few other pictures of the impact it's had across all the different grade levels for every student to lead to all of that success. And now we'd like to give you the opportunity to speak. Yes, do you have a question? We'll run down and we'll be runners.
I only heard about this a few months ago. My coworker was telling me about it. But I have questions about, do you just go in and just let them make anything, or do we? I think one of the video kind of answered this question, but you kind of have a goal in mind of, I mean, you don't want to tell them what to do or how to do it, but you want a specific thing or accomplishment.
So Alex and I, we had a slightly different approach at the beginning of the year, and from what I understand, you actually had them really explore the first few times. For me, I've been teaching for 10 years, and I'm like, I cannot do that. I need to have it structured. I need to have an activity. I need to have a goal, constraints, all of these things. So I, in the beginning of the year, made different units, so a K through 2 unit and 3 through 5. And as the year has evolved, I've gone to the teachers. That's like our biggest goal, is figuring out how to bring the connection to both the classroom and into the innovation lab. And so now we're really trying to be as specific to what they're learning in class. But to answer your question, so I didn't have them really have a whole day of exploration, but I know Alex did, and I know that you thought that was very valuable. Mm-hmm.
So for the first 2 weeks of them experiencing the makerspace, it was free exploration. We put the items on the tables. They were allowed to build literally anything they wanted. I had a student build a flashlight. I had students taking fabric and trying to make a dress out of it. So they were building whatever. And then the thing about it is we saw that we wanted it to have it more structured. And Dr. Okino decided to say, okay, let's close down the makerspace. Let's kind of redesign it, just like the engineering design process. Like Dr. Callella was saying, it is literally the engineering design process. And when you hear the teacher or us say challenges, we'll be explaining it later on today at 2 o'clock, how we come up with challenges, how it's connected to NGSS. But in every single challenge, we try to incorporate STEAM in there. We incorporate the NGSS standards. The engineering standards are in NGSS. And they kind of have a challenge where there's criteria, constraints, and they are still building something. They are still discovering. So it's connected to what they're learning in the classroom and the NGSS standard. And we have those challenges for 2 weeks. So we switch off every 2 weeks.
So from the district level, working in the middle school and the high school now, I understand your perspective and I see the challenges very clearly. Right now, as of until April 1st, actually, there's a grant opportunity out there. You're willing to compete against me and probably tens of thousands of other people trying to build write a grant to build a makerspace in a high school. But we did try. Last year I tried. We got the space. And we were able to do the persuasion enough to be able to get the students. We had the students there. During Club Rush Week, we promoted it. Students came. It ended up turning into an after-school space where the students who were in the robotics club came. It's a very small robotics club. We have a brand new 3D printer. Those kids came and so forth. And the one engineering teacher that we have for Project Lead the Way came and used that space after school. It never got utilized because being able to sell it to the high school teachers was a bigger hurdle than we were ready for. So we decided to just do really well with elementary school this year and then build it on into middle school. And we were bringing on Project Lead the Way, which I know is very common in many schools, but to align it so that there's a bridge from the makerspace into Project Lead the Way. And then when those students leave that, and eventually there'll probably be something that looks a little bit like a makerspace, they're trying to do it in middle school. And then that will push up to high school, because I believe in the sandwich effect. When you have parents asking for something a lot, and you have students coming in with these experiences expecting this, eventually everyone else has to fit in. So it will be the parents and the students who help make that happen in high school. I would guess it will be another year or two before we actually see it happen.
So as you design your makerspace, what would be the one thing, like flexible furniture, someplace to put all the equipment? Like, what is the one thing that stands out for you guys if you were to make one from scratch?
Sorry.
The right person.
Yes.
Okay, the right person really is so, so important to that process. Someone that has that, like, in the energy and the drive to work through the we did this way, those kind of things like that. Somebody who can push through that, still keep the relationships with all of the team members. So I think the single most important thing is the person to lead the project. The space can be variable. The supplies can come from a bunch of different ways. What was the name of the place that you went? Trash for Teaching, something I never thought I'd hear of as a principal. Trash for Teaching, great opportunity. Didn't know I could spend it on my Cal card to that much. I knew how to keep it right under the limit. So like those supplies and all those things fall into place. And really, I think it's having the right person. And we are lucky because both of our schools have the right person.
My question actually goes into yours. We were looking at this. We have a maker. We actually have our space in our elementary, and I'm looking at your presentation. We're really excited because I feel like looking at your presentation, we were kind of speaking and collaborating here, and we're like, okay, we're actually following exactly what you guys are doing. So we're excited that we're doing the right thing. However, my question is, continuously funding it, because eventually you want to move on from tinkering with recycled materials, but to get to the 3D printer and the robotics, how are you planning to fund all that? Is that all site funded, or is the district on board with that? We're just kind of nervous about continuously funding a makerspace.
Okay, so one of the things that we've learned is it doesn't have to be expensive, and we don't always just use recyclable materials. But as far as funding goes, yes, it's commingling a lot of funds. So we have, our parents are excited now, and so we're running fundraisers specifically to support not just the makerspace, but STEAM initiatives throughout the school. So we're raising funds, and our teachers are doing donors choose and writing for grants, getting robots. So we're really like expanding into those other areas.
So we have two partners that are very close to us that would normally you would think would be ideal to support a makerspace. And they're very good partners of our school, but they really haven't done much with makerspace. We're across the street from a Navy base. So the greatest technology organization on planet Earth that's in the public sector is the United States military. So we have a ton of access to that. And they mostly will occasionally come and volunteer. Down the street from us is Boeing, okay? But our best partner for Innovation Lab, the dollar store.
So one of the projects that we did are BristleBots, which I'm sure some of you are familiar with that. And that whole project for second and third grade, which covered 200 students, cost $12. So it's trying to find the materials that are cheaper and materials that you can use each year. And just like I have to buy two more toothbrushes next year, so.
And just like they were saying with the computers that we had, we decided to try to go into a life science challenge project. So our students took apart their computers and they were performing surgery on the computers. So they had to design, you know, their own tools, they had to buy their tools, and they had steps to perform surgery with the circulatory system and everything. So it's very abstract. And again, make it your own. It's every single makerspace is different. And own it and make it your own and it will work for you. So
there's no one right way.
Exactly.
Right? Are there any other questions back there, Alex?
Oh, yes.
I'd really like to hear more about the mobile makerspace. You know, how does that work? The parents and the teachers push into the classrooms?
So, well, both of our sites have a permanent space, but because of some of my ABA classes, they don't quite feel comfortable bringing their kids to the Innovation Lab. So on Uline, if you want to get a cart from Uline that has wheels, they're about $120, and they're very big, and we just take the supplies from our closet where we keep all our supplies and bring it to the classroom. So I think you just need one cart that will fit in a door, make sure it does that, and just bring it to them. Bring buckets, the buckets from the dollar store. They're nice and big, and just bring whatever supplies you need.
Question back there.
I've made BristleBots before
using
the Maker Shed kit.
Okay.
So what at the dollar store would you find to be able to do second and third grade?
So,
I know toothbrushes.
So it's a mechanical toothbrush, but there's two different kinds at the dollar store.
Okay.
And it's the one that you can easily take apart. So buy two, and there's one that just snaps out.
Okay.
And then you just take off the bristle head, and I use popsicle sticks, tape, and just some kind of marbles to weight it down.
Okay.
And that was it.
And that motor, okay, so it's all
the
in.
Motor is it within the toothbrush. And you need one battery per toothbrush.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Thank you.
If you want to write this down, you can have it before you leave. It's GOO.GL/ALUPA6. And that'll give you access to everything except the video and a couple of photos I just took out.
I just want to say thank you for coming and joining us for this session. This has been, I hope it's been helpful to you as you look at exploring Makerspace, Innovation Lab, whatever label you put on it. I really believe it's a great, great thing for children. I think about my own son, and I think about the fact that as soon as he's built his Legos with the directions that come with it, and then he breaks it, I end up with a bucket of Legos underneath the bed that's useless. And part of the reason why is because I don't think we're giving enough kids the types of experiences that they have in Innovation Lab or in Makerspaces. They're so dependent on what are the directions. Once it's become the Death Star and it gets broken, it's death to the Legos. They just live under the bed. And I think that we can change that if we work to create these kind of learning opportunities for our kids. So I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Callella.
There you go. All yours.
Thank you. Enjoy the rest of the conference.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Thank you very much.